In the next 15 minutes, Matthias Arnold and Henrik Rudolph will introduce a database project, a project on digitized historical sources. It's the early Chinese periodicals online database project. Matthias Arnold is a research architect at the University of Heidelberg in Germany. And Henrik Rudolph, whom you have already known now, is the co-organizer of this conference and an assistant professor of Chinese history at University of Göttingen.
Thanks again for the organizers to give us the chance to present the database here at the conference. For more than 10 years, we have studied early Chinese periodicals with a focus on the Republican era. The primary challenge was to gather the material and make it available online. Our team consisted of more than 10 researchers and PhD students. And in 2018, we celebrated the publication of the edited volume, A Space of Their Own, published by Cambridge University Press. Digitally, the approach of the project was the creation of the ECPO database. The early Chinese periodicals online database builds up on and significantly expands the outcome of earlier research projects. One focused on early women's periodicals and recorded every detail about articles, images, advertisements, and agents in what we call the intensive approach. Another recorded characteristics of individual entertainment newspapers in what we call the extensive approach. We further expanded it with data from Academia Sinica in Taiwan and a selection of literary, art, and political magazines, as well as Western languages published in China. As it currently stands, ECPO provides open access to over 300 publications from the early Republican period mostly, comprising over 300,000 scans of printed pages and the manually recorded data of about half of the publications. Database records, as the one you can see here, contain bibliographic metadata in Chinese with pinyin transcription and often an English translation, genre and column information, and our own research-based content analysis in the form of subject headings. We also identify names and roles of agents associated with an item, including those that are just mentioned in an article or depicted on an image. For a number of periodicals, we create detailed information about their publishing history, including publication frequency, changes in format and size, or changes of the price. In recent years, we have begun to open the ECPO system by introducing a number of services. For example, the export of bibliographic metadata in Mods XML, the implementation of a IIIF image service, and the development of a cross-database agent service. This chart shows main data sets within ECPO, which may not all contain image scans, but all features information about agents. So what actually started just as a byproduct has now become a significant part of the ECPO system, our agent service. Here, we can assign the 55,000 names and more that occur in the sources to their actual agents, which can be individuals that sometimes are only known from this one source we have, groups, institutions, and so on. The main challenge here is disambiguation. Do similar names all belong to the same agent? Do we have to split them into different agents? Or do we have to merge multiple name records into one agent? Solving this for all agents is one of the tasks we are currently working on, and surely that will keep us busy for quite some time. So far from my side, now Henrike will talk more about the network perspective of our agent service.
Yes, because now the question is, what makes this database interesting if you want to do network research? And there are certain possibilities that this database offers. And Matthias already mentioned the agent service, and agents can be persons or more broadly understood as institutions or organizations like a university, but it could also be a political party or any other group or organization. And these groups, of course, also had their events. Events could be conferences, they could be meetings, but events could also be publications in which different people participate guided, for example, the publication of a journal or a book. And these events are, of course, time sensitive. If it's a meeting, it had a certain place and a certain date. If it's a publication, it also has a publishing place and a date. And you can, of course, then tie these different things together, because this is, I need the previous slide again.
Sorry.
Yeah, because these ties also then have different typologies, of course. You have ties between people when they, we know whether they're married to, parent of, mentor of, but you also saw for the CBDB network, some of course reciprocal. If you have the parent of, then of course the other person is also at the same time the child of. But then we also have what we in network terms call bimodal networks, which means that we have networks or ties that connect persons and institutions, because someone worked at an institution, was a member of a certain organization, and so on. Or between persons and events, people participated in, etc. I already mentioned that. And now the next slide. What you can also do, of course, is not only map these kind of social relationships, but as Matthias already mentioned, in what we have for a vast amount of these digitized sources in the database is that people are actually linked to certain publications. So either because they're the authors of, or because they're mentioned in or depicted on a picture. So you can actually track co-occurrences, that two people are mentioned in the same text. You can track co-authorships, two people publishing the same text, working on the same text. Or you can also see whether certain journals had overlapping authorships, right? That certain groups came together in certain journals, and that maybe these social groups also overlapped. I just made this as a very quick example. This is the network of Song Qingling and how she published in different journals, what she published and who was kind of involved in the same publications with her. And the next slide. This means that we can map social ties in the temporal and spatial dimension. But we can also map participation in events and institutions. And so this is where EPPO is different from its inception from other databases, because it's not strictly a biographical database, because it was started as a database containing textual sources. And as Matthias just said, the agent service is a byproduct. What is also nice about this data set is the potential not to make certain parts of the data set accessible to the public. Of course, the fair data guidelines always suggest we should share data, but sometimes, for example, in the people I work with or the data I work with, I also need to consider protecting certain people, because I'm working on modern China, so people might still be alive and you can't simply share personal data. So that's also an option in this database. And when we look at what the database can achieve in the future, it's research driven, so it's still expanding. We can still accommodate new data sets or projects or new source material. We can link our data sets to other data sets like the GND, the VF, Wikidata, the Wikipedia, or Baidu Baikal. So that's a very great potential, because this means we could actually also link to other databases like the Modern China Biographical Database, because then we have these kind of references that we can use across databases. And we require, of course, also ways to cure the database via IPAs and these kind of unique persistent identifiers. And ideally, of course, this is something for the future and where work still needs to be put into. All data should become part of international authorities, or basic agent data should be added to Wikidata and all other references to kind of trace occurrences. And I will end with this to take some questions here, some further reading. We already uploaded the slides, so you can take a look if you like. And I'll end with that. And Thank you for your attention.